Coffee brewed in my place. word, our prayer this morning as we go in to this communion service.
Holy Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, Lord, we come before your presence this morning with thanksgiving. We have so many things, O Lord, to thank you for. We thank you, O Lord, first of all, for these brothers and sisters that are gathered here in the house of prayer. We thank you, Lord, that we have been blessed to meet you. Raise our voices and mingle our voices together and sing praise to your holy and righteous name. Lord, what a privilege it is to meet at the house of prayer. Father, it's a greater privilege when you meet us here in the power of your Holy Spirit. It enables us, O Lord, to worship you in spirit and in truth. And as we come this morning, O Lord, we ask you to tune our hearts to sing your praise. Father, we're so thankful for the joy and the fellowship that we have been blessed to enjoy. We thank you, O Lord, for the saints that we've met on this journey. We thank you, O Lord, for the praise and for the service that we've been able, in our feeble way, to render unto the Lord for all of his benefits. When we look back over our lives, we can say with the servant David, what shall I render to the Lord for all of his benefits? We're so thankful this morning. We're thankful for every family, O Lord, that's represented here this morning. We ask you to be with them, lead them, and guide them. We pray, O Heavenly Father, for the shepherd of this flock. We pray that you will strengthen him, O Lord, where he's weak. Build him up where he's torn down, and prop him up, O Lord, on every leaning side. Father, bless his companion this morning who stood by his side. We're just so thankful, O Lord. We just can't thank you enough for all the goodness that you've done toward us. And when we realize, O Lord, that we didn't deserve any of it, as a matter of fact, we deserve the opposite. But we have learned on this journey that your grace is sufficient. And we thank you, O Lord, for your grace. And as we enter, O Lord, into our communion service this morning, let us remember the words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As often as you do, take this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth my suffering until I meet again.
Yes.
Until I come again. Heavenly Father, we bow down this morning to wash each other's feet. Give us an humble mind and humble spirit. Lord, I'm so thankful this morning. I'm thankful for the brothers and sisters that are gathered here this morning. And we know that no doubt some are burdened down with the cares of this world. Let them hear your voice say that cast your burdens on the Lord and leave them there. We're so thankful this morning, oh Lord. I can't thank you enough. And Father, as we leave from this place, go back to our many homes, oh Lord. We ask you to guide us safely over the street, the dangerous streets and highways, that we may safely make it back home. And Lord, when we arrive at home, we pray that we'll find all things well. These, oh Lord, and all of the blessings we ask in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I thank God this morning that come for me to be here and at this special time. This always has been a very special time for me. To try in my weak mind to explain what we're doing and why we're doing it.
Yeah.
It's so important, I wish that I had the word that could convey to you how serious it is and what a blessing it is.
Right.
To be able to come together like this and try to remember what Jesus did when he was here. And it was so important to him that he didn't even invite his mother into that congregation when he instituted what we're about to do. He wanted those that had been with him for 3 years and he had diligently taught them. He wanted them to know exactly what he was doing and why he was doing it. Because they were going to be charged to teach others to do the same. These times are very emotional to me. Because they're so special. That the jewel of heaven was about to do something for me that could be done no other way. And wanted me, I'm making it personal, because it is personal.
That's right, yeah. Amen.
He wanted me to know what he was doing and why he was doing it. Mm-hmm. He wanted me to know, listen, there's no other way you could ever see my face in peace except I go this way.
Right.
And I want you out of all your busy times, every once in a while, stop. Put everything else out of your mind. And just take a little piece of bread and focus on what I had to go through
here.
For you, church, this is personal.
Yeah.
I wish I had the words to convey to you, and it's so beautiful to behold when we see it through clear eyes. The Lord said, I looked and there was none to help me. I wondered and there was none to hope. The only way justice could be satisfied, God himself had to create a special body. For the second part of the Trinity to live in. Can you imagine that? No other way could it be done. And when the angel appeared to Mary and told her that she was going to have a, not me, I haven't had nothing to do with the man. She knew. But the only way that she could procreate, she had to be infused by no man. But I haven't had anything to do with it. Mary is coming down by God. The Holy Ghost. Yes, Lord, I'm going to take over your body and the Spirit of the Most High. It's going to overshadow you. You shall. Not mine, but you shall receive. And bring forth the Son. and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall. God was speaking in positive terms. He wasn't saying he might save, or he will give you an opportunity to save yourself, but he shall save his people from that sin. What a blessing it is today to stand here and try. In my weak way to tell you what the Lord did for each one of you that feel kinship to him. All the money in the world couldn't do it. There was no human being alive or dead could do it. God himself had the fashion of life. And then live in that body and let sinful human beings still call it everything where a child would go. Hanging on the cross. Can you imagine God letting sinners do that to him? Can you focus on that? And when he got ready to go there, he sat down with the 12. And as they were eating the Passover, and I know their minds were confused at what he was doing.
Yes.
He took the same word and he broke, looked up to God and blessed. And he broke and said, "Take heed. This is my body. I wish I could tell you what was going on, but I don't have the words to explain it. This is God, the creator of everything you see. This was God doing this."
That's right.
The creator of the universe. Knowing that in just a short while, I'm going to be treated like a common thief. I'm going to be abused like no other human being has ever been abused. For you. And I want you to remember, I'm doing this for you. Oh, I wish I could bring it home to you. There was a time in my short years of trying to preach God's word that I didn't understand this. I really didn't. I acknowledge to you I didn't understand it. But one day, we were getting ready to go into communion at Mount Zion Church in Vallejo. I got ready while my first wife, who gave me 5 children, was getting the children ready. I walked outside. Not there, God met me. And he taught me communion and feet washing. I'll never forget it as long as I live. He made me understand what it costs for me just to say, "Have mercy, Lord."
Yeah.
He had me know what it cost for me to feel like I have a home. Beyond the severe teeth. It cost God a lot.
Yes.
Can you imagine the creator of this universe letting those he created treat him like a common criminal? Can you imagine that? Would you do it? Ask yourself that question. Would I do it? When I had the power just to speak in the Holy Ghost.
Yeah, right.
I had the power to speak and it would all disappear. But because I love you, I'm going to do something for you that could be done no other way. I'm going to suffer the abuse of sinners. Ooh. That one day I could take you home to be his baby. But I want you to remember as much as you can of what I'm doing. So he took bread and he blessed it. And he break and he gave it to take, eat. This is my body. That's broken for you. Church, can you imagine God doing that for you? He didn't have to do it, but he did it because he loved you. And there was no other way it could be done.
Right.
No other way possible. Jesus himself pleaded with God, if there is any other way, take it away from me. But not my will. Thy will be done. I get so emotional at this time because I know who I am and what I am.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
I know I am not worthy. Not one bit worthy of any blessing that I ever received from God. I don't care how good I be, I can never be good enough. But because he loved me, and I look at myself in the mirror, I think how good God is.
Yeah.
And he took all of my faults. And I have a man. He took them all. Every stripe that he felt was aimed at me. I deserved it. He didn't. But he took it from me. In his timeline, come to this timeline, I feel so thankful.
Amen.
Words cannot describe how thankful I am.
Yeah.
And no, not only that, I'm thankful, but he gave me the job of trying to tell you what he did for us.
Hmm.
What a God we serve.
Amen.
And he based it all on love. You know, we human beings are so fickle. We use love. Oh, I love you, I love that, I love you. I don't even know what love is all about. If you really want to understand love, look out on
Calvary.
There is true love out there hanging on the cross. For me, for my sin. And he said, if you love me. If you love me. Every once in a while, come and tell me. Take a little piece of bread and remember my suffering. I can't help but shed a tear because I know how sinful I am. I know how unworthy I am. But I stand here justified in the sight of God.
That's right.
Because of what he did.
Amen.
When Brother Jerry asked me to do this, I almost fainted because I know what this is all about. Not about me. No, no. This is about me. This is about someone who took my place. Someone who took the place that I deserve.
That's right.
And then he said, if you love me. Every once in a while, I want you to stop in your busy lives and remember my suffering. You know what that means? That if we remember his suffering for us, we'll be a little more careful how we live. We'll be a little bit more careful of how we connect ourselves out there as a representative of the one who died for us. Don't it make you a little bit more careful how you live?
Yeah.
When you remember what the price was? Wasn't cheap? No, no. God himself had to be this. Couldn't be done no other way. And if you love me, keep my commandments.
Right.
I think on the Sasta Garden with you on this, because I can't tell it all. I don't know enough. All I know is I'm thankful today. Thankful right now. That in a few moments, I'm going to take a little piece of bread. And my focus is not going to be on the bread. My focus is going to be on Jesus.
Amen. That's right.
I'm going to say, Lord, you told me to do it. And in obedience to you, I'm doing it. Because you did for me that I could not do for myself. And I'm just thankful. One day you said you were coming back for me. Because you wanted me to be where you are. close out my statement. Time is running out for me here. But I'm going to come over there. One day I won't leave here. Because this world is not my permanent home. I'm only a temporary dwelling here. I got another place.
Yeah.
And I'm looking forward to being there. I want to see him who died alone.
That's right. Amen. Yes.
Thank you all for guiding me.
Yeah.
He took the word of Christ. We're going to ask you to tell him to pray and ask God to bless you.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, as we bow before thee at this time, Lord, we want to thank you for that you have done. For that that was accomplished on Calvary, Lord. And the evidence in the resurrection of our Savior, Lord, the atonement was acceptable unto you. Lord, that we have set this time aside, that we remember those things that Christ himself told us to remember. But as often as we do this, we do it in his remembrance. Lord, we know that we can't bless this as before us, but we ask, Lord, that you would bless the bread that we will partake of. Lord, that as we partake of it, that we remind ourselves that it sets deep within us that this is representative of the broken body of Christ. Lord, his body was broken for each of us individually. And Lord, had it just been one, it would have required the same payment. But Lord, we're thankful that the book of life is written full of names that you have chosen. Lord, we're thankful that those dear loved ones who have gone on before and are now basking with you, that we one day will reunite with them, we'll rejoin them, Lord, but most especially, we'll be united with you. Lord, that we will see you face to face. We will know you as we have never known you before. Lord, as we're here today, just give us the remembrance of all that you did for us and you continue to do for us in life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Bill, Brother Jim, would you please come and wait on the brothers and sisters? so blessed to be put in that frame of mind by this dear brother beside me. Yeah. Thank the Lord for his words and for being able to share the service with him today and the example of faith in his life.
Yeah.
And it has been in mine. And what I'm going to say, a lot of it's going to be the same things as dear brother has said, with less sufficient words than me. Yet the Lord's called us to try to represent him in the service that our eyes might be focused upon our Savior. After taking bread, we know that we also take wine with you in service. And these are two symbols that are set before us. And while they're symbols, they're specifically chosen symbols that he has given us with specific purpose, that it's unleavened bread because it's the sinless body of our Savior. And it's with specific purpose that it's wine that's set before us, because it denotes the sinless nature of our Savior. In 1 Peter chapter 1, Peter, writing in his epistle, uses the word precious more than any other New Testament writer. And in 1 Peter chapter 1, he says this, verse 13, "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hold to the end for the grace that is to be wrought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy." And if ye call on the Father, who without respect of persons judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by the tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God."
Right.
He tells us here that we were redeemed not with corruptible things, such as silver or gold. You know, those are probably the two least corruptible things in this world. And yet, here Peter says, they're corruptible. He also says that that's the vain conversation of the tradition of man, is that we're redeemed by corruptible things.
Yeah.
And you know, that idea is still out in the world, that redemption somehow occurs through corruptible things. Through men preaching the gospel,
right?
Through monetary efforts to send the gospel to other places. But this passage here tells us that our redemption comes not through corruptible things, but through solely the blood of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Peter says that this blood is precious. We call a lot of things precious in our life. I encourage you to look at the list that Peter gave of what was precious.
Right.
They're all eternal things. And the blood of Jesus Christ is something that is quantifiably precious. But in our perception of the blood of Christ, we often don't see it just as precious as it truly is. And part of the importance of the service, and why I appreciate what Brother Madison said so very much, is that we might have a better, clearer view of just how precious our Savior is. That word is used three times in relation just to Jesus Christ by Peter. How precious our Savior is, and how precious his blood that he shed upon the cross of Calvary is towards us. He says that we were redeemed. First of all, that tells us that we were owned beforehand. Before we needed salvation, before we needed redemption, even before the foundation of the world, we were the Lord's.
We were his children from all eternity.
Right.
But because of sin and falling into sin, we needed to be redeemed out of where we fell to. And that redemption, that buying back, occurred solely by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Right.
When you think about the blood of Jesus Christ, I believe that's more than just the literal drops that fell. The Old Testament tells us several places that for the flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, we shall not eat.
That's right.
That in the blood is life. And when we see that Jesus shed his blood for us, you spoke of that body that was prepared for him. Our Savior gave his life upon the cross of Calvary.
Right.
That it's the preciousness of his blood, which is his life, that he gave for us to redeem us. It says that the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom. A ransom for many. You see, that life was the payment for our sins. How precious is that? You mentioned several times, brother, and I'm not going to change any word that you said, but you mentioned several times that there was no other way. And truly, there was no other way than through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That is the only hope for a remedy for our sin.
Amen.
Is the blood of Christ.
That's it.
It's not just one available option.
No.
If we don't have the blood of Christ, we have no hope for redemption.
Amen.
That's right. How precious is it? There's no plan B. There's no other alternative. Only the blood of Christ will satisfy the debt of our sin. Yet Isaiah 1 tells us that though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Well, how do we go from being so sinful to so righteous? We've been washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, in Revelations, we have a different picture of what we're going to be like when we get to glory. He says, unto him that loved us, that's to Jesus Christ, and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
That's right.
Just how precious is that blood? It's the only thing that can take a sinful creature like me, like you, and make us righteous before God. This blood is so powerful that it not just cleansed us, but it can cleanse his entire family. Now, folks, when Mary came and she broke the ointment on Jesus' feet, you know, people got upset, didn't they, brother?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because they were worried about the money that was being wasted.
Yeah.
He was worthy.
Right.
He was worthy.
Right.
That was corruptible goods. He's worthy. That wasn't a moment of waste. That was a moment of worship.
Yeah. Right.
May our lives be defined by seeing service to the Lord, not as waste, but as worship.
Amen.
But that precious ointment that was spilled upon his feet, they began to be worried that it'd be wasted. When Jesus spilt his blood upon the cross, we are assured that nothing was wasted. He merely did not make salvation available for those who would come and partake of his blood, but he also guaranteed the application of that blood through the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Every time I have ministered communion service, some wine gets spilled. Some wine gets wasted.
Mm-hmm.
But not a drop of our Savior's blood was
right.
Wasted.
Right.
No, it's far too precious,
right?
Far too precious. And that blood redeemed his entire family out of every nation, out of every kindred, out of every tribe and tongue of people, and secured their redemption. And it's too precious that we might be the ones to pass it out. You see, we pass the symbol.
Yeah.
And how precious is that symbol? But it doesn't hold anything to the blood of Jesus Christ. I don't want the responsibility of making sure all of his people receive his blood. But thankfully, that's been done by God himself, because it was so important to him not to lose a single one of his children that he bestows the merit of his life, of his blood, of his righteousness upon his children. I believe in the new birth. It was accounted to them upon the cross.
Right.
But then it's applied in their heart upon the new birth by the Holy Spirit. 1 Peter says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit,
right,
unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. You say, how does that happen? By the sanctification of the Spirit.
Right.
At that moment when the Spirit sets you apart into newness of life,
right,
there is a sprinkling of the blood upon you. We often think of the picture of the blood that they came out under the lamb out of Egypt, and of the man, the father, that would put the blood upon the doorpost of the lamb. And sometimes people say, well, you got to make sure that you have the blood applied. Well, Scripture tells us that Christ is our Passover. From start to finish, Christ is the Passover.
That's right.
He's the Passover lamb.
Right.
He's the father of the household, right, that makes sure the blood is applied.
Right.
By the way, he's also the one that comes and brings vengeance upon those that aren't his. He is the Passover.
He is.
He has applied the blood to our hearts.
Yeah.
Precious blood of Jesus Christ. There's so much more, and as Brother Madison says, you say, well, why do we say that? Because it's so true, words aren't good enough to communicate how precious this is. But I want us to try it. Because the Lord wouldn't have us to take this unworthily.
Right.
But we need to rightly discern the body of Christ.
Yeah.
We need to try to understand the valuation of the blood of Christ.
That's
and
right.
How precious it is. But we'll never arrive. Strive to understand that.
Right.
But I want to put one more thought in your mind before we take this wine. Is that here's the precious life of Christ, the blood of Jesus Christ. And God thought that you were so precious that he gave his son. Because in his eyes, you are precious.
Amen.
Isaiah 43 says this. But now, thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by my name, thou art mine. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. And when thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I have gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee. Since thou wast precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I love thee. Therefore, I will give men for thee and people for thy life. But all the most precious life David gave was that of his own son.
That's right.
For God so loved the world of his people, that he gave his only begotten son. That's how precious you are, that he would pay the ransom of the price of the blood, the life of his only begotten son.
Right.
He tells us to give thanks for his blood.
Amen. Yes, sir.
And when we think about that, I want to make this one more point from 1 Peter where I read. Say, well, why did you read so much from 1 Peter? Because, you know, in that beginning of that chapter said some very startling words that are repeated over and over in Scripture. It says, be ye holy, for I am holy. When I look at that measuring stick in my life, I say, say I'm not there.
Yeah.
That's right. And I confess I'm not going to get there in this life.
I'm going to try.
How much more precious is the blood of Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
When you consider that.
Yeah.
It says you were redeemed not with corruptible things. Our redemption is not going to fade away with things such as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without spot, without blemish, and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him, who believe in God, have raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope, let it be fully in God. He is the hope of our redemption.
Yes.
And that's what we need to remember this morning as we take the wine that is a symbol of the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus, in establishing this ordinance, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of the fruit of this vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. You know, this blood, this wine, which is a symbol of the blood of Christ, gives us hope for that which is to come.
Yeah.
Because he lives,
right,
we shall live also. He tells us to give thanks. I'd like to ask you, Brother Eugene, would you pray to the Lord and give thanks for the wine before us as a symbol of his blood? Pray that the Lord would bless us as we take it.
Unto an all-wise and almighty God, to him that rules and superrules both heavens and the earth, unto the author and finisher of every good and perfect work, it is before thee and in thy presence one more time, Heavenly Father, that this unworthy servant comes, even and body bowed, one more time with head facing towards Mother Dust. Just want to thank you, Father, for times and circumstances being as well with me as they are. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father, for the laying down last night and the early rising this morning. I want to thank you, Father, for the companion who lay down with me. And for some reason this morning, you touched us both with your finger of love. Our eyes became open, and behold, we see a new day that has never been seen before. And I want to thank you, Lord, while the blood is running warm in my vein. I want to thank you, O Heavenly Father, for watching over us as we traveled over the dangerous highways. I want to thank you one more time for leading us and enabling us to meet one more time at this appointed place, to carry out the ordinance that your days past have gone that you told us to do. Told us as often as we do it in remembrance of thee. And I want to thank you, Father, for having the mind to serve the one true and the living God. I want to thank you for the fellowships and friendships that we've developed over these years. Continue to go with us and bind us together, Heavenly Father. Continue to bless this service. That we've come together one more time to honor thee and try with our weak ways and limited understanding to do the things that you would have us to do. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving thy darling son Jesus. I want to thank you for giving him to stand in our stead, for the blood that ran down his side and washed our sins away. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father, when he said in his word that though our sins be as scarlet, he would make them whiter than snow. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father. And now, Lord, if you would be so pleased, I would turn every mind towards Calvary. The wine that we drink, Lord, would you be so pleased to bless it, Father? I would change it from a natural use unto a spiritual use. Let every mind remember that blood as the wine goes down our throats. I remember the blood that shed from his body to wash our sins away. Oh, and no other way. Oh, as the minister said, oh, and no other options. Oh, and no other alternative. Only one way, by the shed blood of Jesus. I want to thank you, Heavenly Father. One more time. I just can't thank you enough. But you know my heart. You know my heart's desires. You know, Lord, that I'm so thankful. I just can't say it enough. I just can't feel it enough. What you've done for us. But Heavenly Lord, every mind, let us lay aside our things of this world. Let us remember now the blood, as we took the bread, as it was chewing on it. It was so strange, Lord, just chewing that bread, thinking about every lash that my Savior suffered for my sake. And now this blood, this wine, as it goes down our throat, I remember the blood that poured out on Calvary to wash all our sins away. I can't thank you enough. And Lord, let our mind be so pure as the only thing of the shed blood of Jesus and all that he has done for us. I don't just can't say thank you. One day, Lord, I look forward to that day when I can look you in the eye and say thank you for all that you have done. And thank you for our salvation. Sing a song that the angels cannot sing, that they can't even understand. But we know, Heavenly Father, all the suffering that you went through for our sake, the beatings that you took for our sake, the nailing to the cross that you endured for our sake. Heavenly Father, just look down upon this poor babe. Bless us each individually and collectively. These blessings I ask in the name of Christ Jesus and for his sake. Amen.
Brother Bill, Brother Jim, please wait.
serving him with bread and wine. Then he did something that was so lazy. He laid his hand in garlic and poured water in a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet. I want you to think of something. There was only one just man in that room.
That's you, yeah.
All of the rest of them are sinners.
Yeah, right.
Here's the holy bowing down to the unholy and washing their feet. What a picture and what a lesson. Mommy. And then after he was, before he went to that, he came to Peter. Lord, you wash my feet. What I'm doing up for you, you don't know, but be patient. I'll tell you when I'm done. Lord, you shall never wash my feet. There's one thing about Jesus, he didn't argue with you. If I washed you, not you have no part of it. Lord, not only my feet, but wash me all over. And Jesus said, he that is washed, need not save to wash his feet, but it's clean everywhere.
Yeah.
Have you ever taken a bath and left your feet out of the tube? That's what he was talking about. You take a bath, you wash all over. But here he was teaching something
different.
It wasn't about dirty feet. It was about something else. I wonder, those of us that are sitting here, have you always kept the rules according to what's laid down here in the book? Have you ever made an error on your walks with the Lord? Or have you been perfect all the time? If you made an error, your feet got dirty. Sometimes in this life, we misunderstand the lesson that the Lord teaches. And so many times, I've made mistakes and wanted to quit. But somebody in the congregation that I'm supposed to be serving, served me, came along the side. Brother Watson, don't quit. Don't give up. You're important to us. They were washing my feet.
Yeah.
Putting me back in the room.
Yeah.
Not all of them. I was just taking some water and washing feet. If there's ever been a time in your life when somebody told you that you were important, or told you not to quit, don't give up, don't quit, and say to you, we all make mistakes.
That's right.
How precious that is to know that you are among sinners. I'm not the only one. We're all that way. In other words, then you know we're all in the same path.
Yes, we are.
We all make mistakes.
Right.
We're not all perfect. But somebody come along and say, don't give up. How precious that is. Have you ever had anybody come along and tell you that? When you felt discouraged, when you felt like, I'm just around here spinning wheels and going nowhere. I might as well stay home or quit. No use me going to church and somebody coming along and saying, don't quit. Tell them, we need you. How precious that is. Jesus was there where this came so far. He was teaching them a lesson. How important we are to each other. I can't make journey without you all. It would be foolish for me to come out here preaching the message. I need you all as much as you need me. We are in this together.
Yeah, right, brother.
You can be as helpful to me as I am to you. Because I stand up there and preach to you, don't mean you don't have a sermon for me, because I need help too.
Amen. That's right.
Every amen I give when I'm up there trying to preach is helpful to me. And when somebody says, "God bless you, brother, help me today," I need it. That's helpful to me. I want to know, am I helping you? You see what this is? We're all connected. We're all in this thing together. It would be meaningless for the Lord to give me all of this ability to understand His word and nobody to preach. We're in this together. And if I see you in an error, not my job to beat you down, pick you up and say, "You know, let's walk together."
Amen.
I've washed your feet. Put you back in. And you're going to go.
Yeah.
But here, this is so amazing. The jewel of glory. Laying aside, here's gold. Pour water in a basin. And bow down before sinners. The sinless one bowing before sinners. Taking their feet in His holy hand. What a lesson. What a lesson. And sometimes, among us, our folks, I see some running a certain one, and I want to go to the other. What's the matter? Something is wrong here. If there's somebody in the congregation that you don't want to watch their feet, something is wrong.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with the command. The wrong is in me.
Yeah.
I'm saying, without words, I'm better than this sister or this brother. They don't want their feet.
Yeah.
Feet washing the room. Cause you to examine yourself. Cause you to look at yourself.
Yeah.
Am I too good? If I think I'm too good, if I'm down in front of just my little take his feet in my hand and wash his feet, or I scurry over one that I think is just as good as I am. You know what I'm thinking about that?
Yeah.
Feet washing will call you out for it.
Yeah.
And it will let you know who you are to.
Amen.
But just think about the one who is laying down the order. None in that room is worthy of you.
Oh, no.
But yet he took me and Peter, but I wonder if you don't wash my feet. If I don't wash your feet, you don't have no part with me. God, God, I only want you to wash your own room. What a blessing this whole service here. We're all here today in order to be thankful for what we have. Why? This might be your last time. Tomorrow is not promised to any of us.
Yeah.
But we can lay down tonight and say, "Lord, I have tried." What a blessing that is. You know, sometimes we human beings think we are so everybody in here out there. We all are old, but sure we don't know that way.
Right.
We all don't get that big head sometimes, think we're better than somebody else. Do we?
Try not to.
This feet wash will come down.
Amen.
You are too good to wash this brother's foot or this sister's foot. Lay each of us in the hand of our
sins. Right. Amen.
Take a lift inside. Have no better. Let my brother. We just think about it. The jewel of heaven. All of those that were sitting there was nothing but sinners. He did not search for anyone. He took them on one
to the law. That's right.
And washed their feet and then sat down and said, now I'm going to tell you what I did. You called me Lord. And you called me Master. You have made a mistake. I'm just that. I'm your Lord and I'm your Master. And if I have washed your feet, what you say is, what excuse can you be if I had not to do this? I can't find any. I can't find any. I find no fault in him. I just want to do what he commanded.
That's right.
Me.
That's right.
And what a joy it is to me. I don't know about you, but to me, just to think, Lord, one more time, I'm doing what you told me to do. Every once in a while, stop, take a little breath, and think about Uncle Martin. Drink a little wine and think about the blood that washed
right.
your sins away.
Amen.
And then put a little water. And raise them. Self-examination time is what he's saying. And then wash your brother's feet. And think of the one who gave you the orders. He said to them, a servant is not greater.
That's right.
That is Lord. Neither is he that is sent greater than he that sent. If I mean your Lord and Master yeah. have washed
yeah.
your feet,
yeah.
you also are the worst.
That's right. That's right.
Are we ready to wash
we
your
are.
Feet?
Yeah. Yes,
sir. Yeah. Do we feel blessed to be able to do it one yeah. more time? I do.
Amen.
I certainly do.
Yes.
God bless all of you. I thank God that I'm able to be with you. Today.
Yeah, amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
It's such a blessing to have this privilege to have gone through this service. There's something very interesting and unique about this service in comparison to all others. In that, they had finished washing one another's feet. They just sang a song and went out. There was no formal conclusion to the service. That's very fitting, certainly in light of what Elder Madison said. I was watching with the saints speak. It's a great opportunity for self-examination. And I'll tell you, if we would live our lives at the feet of one another, not literally, but internally, at the feet of one another, how much better would our fellowship be? How more inclined would we be to treat one another as the Lord would have us treat one another? So therefore, they sang a song and went out, and it's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to sing a couple of hymns, give one another the right hand of fellowship, and I trust take this that we have observed and partaken in out in service unto the Lord and to the Lord's people. Let's sing number 296 as a starting point, and somebody else can grab one after that.
The Lord has been so good to me, I want to sing His praise. I want to go.
Thank you.